Crystal Maiden.
Elder Titan.
Seconds remaining. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. 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 10 seconds remaining.
Brood mother.
Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Seconds remaining.
Shadow Fiend.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Ah!
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Seconds remaining.
Razor.
10 seconds
Elder
remaining.
Magi!
10 seconds remaining.
That's right, definitely starting things out on an interesting note. An Elder Titan being picked up, a hero that hasn't won in quite some time, and not that surprising, though. I mean, Team Secret already brought a little innovation into this tournament with their first series with the Alchemist pickup and how they were finally able to make that Aghanim's trade-off work. Purge, what do you think about Secret's lineup?
I can't do anything except for stare at Secret's lineup and be like, how is this synergy going to come together really well? And the things that I felt like the last couple weeks is that Elder Titan's really good if you have a team that's very physical damage base and also magic. You need a bit of both, because if you go all in on one of them, then you're only getting half of the value out of natural order.
Right.
And the heroes that it's very good against, again, on CDE, it's good against Shadow Fiend. He's an agility hero, so his base agility that he's getting is going to be removed as armor, and any agility items that he buys that give him armor also going to be put away. And then the same thing goes for Ogre, who has a super high armor. That big armor that you pick the hero for is going to be wasted as soon as Natural Order comes in. Mm-hmm. And same goes for Gyrocopter. You've got three heroes that are basically hard countered by that. Clock doesn't buy that many armor items. Usually he's going to be dying pretty fast. The only real solution they have against it is Winter Wyvern, Cold Embrace, which will stop things like Focus Fire.
Right.
But Secret further went with that. They grabbed Razor, who's a hybrid magic and fit minus armor hero. Crystal Mane does lots of magic damage. Brood does a little bit of both. I just feel like the Elder Titan fits into their draft so well, and it counters a lot of CDEC heroes. The downside is it's a weak support in the early game, kind of. It's very good as only an offlaner, and it's not very good at ganking. So we'll see if it plays in with them very well. But there's a lot of really good things going on with their lineup.
Yeah, I think that Elder Titan just really fits into Team Secret in that they're always able to figure out, like, we see certain strengths of heroes in 6.84, 6.85, talking about, like, the Alchemist, I think, is a prime example. People are like, oh, this whole Aghanim's change up, you know, you could do all these certain things, you know, and people start theory crafting these strategies, and you see some teams try it out, but it doesn't seem to work, and then Team Secret is really seemed to be the team that actually kind of solved it, you know, piecing together this, like, tank up, and then give away eggs, tank up, give away another eggs. And now I'm interested to see how they actually make this Elder Titan work, as, you know, the three position, I recently, you know, casted the MLG finals. Mm-hmm. We had the Bulba actually playing an offlane Elder Titan. Despite the fact that they lost that match, I felt like the Elder Titan pickup itself wasn't actually the big downfall.
Okay.
How did that do team. In lane? So, he did all right in lane, actually. Okay. I think that the part of the problem was that one of the supports was rotating out, so he was only facing up against two heroes. And I think that was a special advantage that the Elder Titan brings, is if you know the lanes are a little bit weaker.
Yeah, I agree.
A strong laning phase, I don't think the Elder Titan's really going to be able to do much. But here in this position as a support, it's definitely a big puzzle piece of, like, where is this actually going to fit into the draft? Where are you going to be getting your experience? How are you going to be going into the mid-game? Because Elder Titan, at least when we last saw him very popularly, was with the Yule Scepter pickup, sometimes an offlaner, sometimes a four position. But he was a little bit greedier. Here, Puppy's playing it next to a Crystal Mane, who's probably going to be getting a bit more farm, just purely due to the fact that you can jungle via that Frostbite.
You know, maybe what the build should be for him is just a Solar Crest. I mean, pretty much nobody's touched the item since it got nerfed. But it's still pretty good. Obviously, it's severely nerfed versus BKB, I would say, is the main thing. It's not amazing against Roshan as it used to be, but it's still great against heroes. If you're buffing your damage up by, you know, 100 damage, and you're already lowering their armor by 10 or so, drop it another 7, drop it another 10, and then all of a sudden you start two-shotting heroes. And even as a support, that's definitely a possibility. It'll solve his mana problem. Sure, it doesn't give him a disable, and it can't necessarily give him as much setup, and his spirit doesn't run as fast, but you can still get by with just Tranquil Boots and a Slow Ring. And I honestly feel like this hero is all right. I just think the area he's really lacking is definitely in the lane.
Yeah.
You can maybe kill support. You can definitely harass the carry. In the late game, you have great teamfight disruption. You just put the spirit on the back line, and then you can just sleep the Winter Wyvern or maybe the Clockwork or something. If they're, like, slept and the rest of your team's fighting, you're just in a great position. So I feel like there's a lot Elder Titan can definitely do this game. He obviously won't be in the offlane this game. Could be dual offlane, maybe, but very unlikely. He'll probably just do a lot of pulling, get some levels, and, you know, just keep transitioning from that.
Right, so just so you guys know, there is one of the players who's having a little bit of issue with his headset, so that's getting squared away right now. But in the meantime, what about the offlane Broodmother that Misery is going to be picking, going up against what probably one of the stronger carries, one versus one against a Broodmother? The gyrocopter at least has some ways to deal with the broodling spam. You have the fly cannon, obviously. You know, rocket barrage can clear through some small things, yeah. And obviously that ultimate is rather helpful as well. I feel like it's very necessary to have that kind of self-sustained carry against a broodmother.
Yeah, I agree with that. The most important thing versus brood right now is that you just apply an AoE spell to the spiderlings, because yes. If you apply an AoE, they actually spread out. Because otherwise it would be too overpowered. Basically like old techies minds. You hit one, and then you right-click again, and you attack a different one. So he does have lots of AoE options, even starting at level 1. He just has to rocket barrage, or he can flat cannon. And like you said, at level 6, he's got cooldown. He can easily kill the spiders if things get really scary. So I feel like I wouldn't want to leave him there forever, because Brood will get an advantage once mm-hmm. he gets like level 3. And then he gets a soaring, can start spamming nukes on Gyro to keep his HP low, and that's when you're looking for a kill.
Yeah.
So he can't be solo, but they do have an ogre with 8 armor as soon as he buys an Ironwood branch. So I feel like he's going to have an okay time just denying creeps, maybe putting a sentry down, trying to zone the Brood kind of a thing.
Yeah, and then look at the rest of the AoE on CDC. You have the Splinter Blast that comes in from the Winter Wyvern. That's going to be great
really
with dealing. Yeah, I mean, that's just free gold. That's going to be racking in for Q every single time. Sheiky is, you know, the mid laner actually offers a decent amount of AoE to deal with Broodmother pushes as well. So yep. If Gyro wants to get aggressive early on, the first 15 to 20 minutes, you have maybe the SF rotates down to that bottom lane, stays against him. And even the rocket coming out from the Clockwork is not actually a bad way to deal with the Broodmother. So yep. I feel like CDC's lineup was actually just going into the Broodmother pickup by Secret. Was already pretty good, and then, you know, they even got a little bit better after that.
Yeah, I agree with that a lot. I feel like a lot of the other teams are so worried about Brood that they're like, we have to pick the hard counters, but mm-hmm. CDEC is just kind of saying, well, we've got heroes that can deal with it. Maybe the laning stage isn't going to go perfectly, but we're good enough players where we're going to weather the storm. You're still going to have a decent Brood game. We'll deal with that later. The most important thing is we want a good early game, and we don't want to have to pick ourselves in corners, similar to something that maybe EG did yesterday. I think that's what they're aiming for, and they've got really good ganking supports. Mm-hmm. Winter Wyvern and Ogre, I think just zone the Brood a little bit, give Jaro a decent start, let him get a boots advantage over Brood, and then go move around the map and kill people, because they've got an Elder Titan. This guy has a decent chance of defending level 1. Like, yeah, sure, he could TP to a lane and do a Spirit Stomp, and the Stomp AoE is bigger, and it sleeps for 2 seconds. That'll buy you time. That'll keep somebody alive in the mid lane. So mm-hmm. I think that's really all Secret can do. They can gank early, but their gank is not nearly as good as what CDEC has.
And then you continue that pressure with the Clockwork, being able to pick up his level 6 and obviously have a bit more impact around the map than mm-hmm. compared to the Broodmother. It seems like CDEC, I mean, straight into their wheelhouse, is going to be playing, you know, very aggressively into that 20-minute marker, looking for a lot of team fights, and they're going to be the first ones truly rotating around, while Secret may be spending a lot more time sitting back and farming. What about our Razor here? Eternal Envy, safe lane Razor. Farm-wise, what are we looking at? Like, builds, do we still go for the mech pickup that we used to see on certain Razors, despite the, you know, nerf that it received in previous patch with the heavy mana cost that really taxes the Razor's somewhat limited mana pool a bit?
Yeah.
Or do you go for more stat-based items?
I agree with mech. I think he's definitely the most natural mech carrier on the team. You obviously don't build on a Windranger.
Yeah.
Maybe there's a chance we could see it on Elder Titan, but he's probably not going to get that much farm. I completely
yeah.
agree with you. A mech fast. And then this is probably an Ags game. We've already got tons of minus armor from the Elder Titan natural order. If you throw a little bit more minus armor on top of that, heroes like Gyrocopter who pop BKBs, you're like, why did I buy a BKB at that point? Because he's going to lose like 15 armor or something in the mid to late game, and then throw a couple Ags hits on top of that, and then his BKB does nothing. There's just going to be a single focus fire from Windranger, and he's going to go down. And we're going to see that a lot this game, if the game is even at all. So I think the fast mech into an Ags is going to be the build. He may grab a BKB as well, because it is decent against Winter Wyvern,
yeah.
among other things. I have an interesting question. So if Winter Wyvern ulties somebody, and Elder Titan hits them, his aura does not apply, correct?
No, I don't believe
it
so.
It just makes you attack. It doesn't, like, turn everything
yeah.
you have
yeah,
on
exactly.
them.
Okay. Yeah, exactly.
So that's, Winter Wyvern's still all right here, by all means. Still going to be a decent hero, but it's not, like, going to completely turn the team fight.
Yeah, I think the Cold Embrace is really going to come into, like, it's going to be a big counter to, occasionally to the Razor, obviously, you mm-hmm. know, there's the worry about both the Lightning Storm as well as the Drain still going on, you know, so yeah, maybe you're invulnerable to that physical damage, but you're losing all your damage and you're getting minus armor, but between the single target focus of the Razor as well as the focus fire from the Windranger, I think the Winter Wyvern actually has a lot of opportunities to be a big playmaker in this game, and being able to counter whatever Secret tried to focus down at a time.
Yeah, exactly. He can even block some of the damage that Elder Titan does. You can stop half of the Earth Splitter damage if you Cold Embrace somebody. There's a lot of things that you can do with it. So.
All right, guys. Well, we're going to take a short little break here because we have Zoe. Interview with Zoe and Hans. And we're back into the start of the game here. Game one between CDEC and Team Secret. We have things start off. Team Secret have actually already gone for the early TP on Pylai Dai, gotten a very early aggressive ward down, and a top rune ward up as well. So early vision being key for Team Secret. CDEC just now spreading out amongst their own jungle, setting up for that bottom lane bounty rune.
Yeah, the reason they put this Observer Ward down is because they were expecting CDEC to do an aggressive tri-lane, but in reality, they're not even going up there, so this Observer Ward will make it a little easier for their supports to zone the offlane hero, but it's a bit of a waste, but not the end of the world.
I feel like this is the Razor versus Clockwork. It's going to be such a rough matchup that they can actually... I'm not entirely sure. We still haven't locked down exactly what Puppy's game plan is going to be in the first 5 minutes. If he's going to be spending time in lane, maybe zoning out the Clockwork, melee versus melee, or if they're going to be spending time more moving around, stacking up camps. I mean, that's a huge possibility with the Elder Titan Astral Spirit, is that you can stack up multiple camps.
That's a good point. I think what he's going to go do is hit heroes, because he has a Scout Shield, so...
Yeah,
punch me, and then he'll punch him back for way more damage, so mm-hmm. It's going to be a little tough for Clock. And Clock didn't even go Stout Shield first, he went Boots first, which isn't very good in this situation, because if Elder Titan gets a bit of movement speed bonus, he's going to have the movement speed advantage, and he's going to hit harder, and he has a Stout Shield, so
right.
This Clock's going to have a really rough time if he doesn't start blocking creeps with Cogs, which naturally he will do.
Yeah, so starting off already an early set of Cogs right next to that Tier 1 tower. I think another thing this ward is going to make even more dangerous for this Clockwork is that when he sits forward in lane, you know, even if he's trying to hide in the Secret Shop or something like that, they're going to be able to, or the side shop, they're going to be able to see that, right? Yeah. And if the Crystal Lane rotates over, you know, get the Frostbite with the Static Link kicking in, all of a sudden the Razor's getting a lot of extra damage. And this is just going to be a lane where they can afford to give a little bit of a solo lane to Eternal Envy because he can zone out a Clockwork. One versus one.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that develops. The Radiant Observer Ward is checking for rotations from the top lane to mid because they obviously want to protect their Shadow Fiend. But if they end up doing smokes and things like that, it's still going to be tough. Oh, I really like Garter's play here. He says Crystal Maiden is trying to get a free level 2. I'm just going to stand in the jungle and there's nothing you can do about it.
Uh-oh, Misery's going to be going down here in the bottom lane. That will be our first blood as Aggressive in Q ended up locking him down with two different Sentry Wards, and Misery didn't really have anywhere to go. That comes in part due to the early spiderweb that he laid down on top of the rune area.
Well, he could get both with one sentry if he does a really fast double tango.
Yeah.
That would be very difficult against these guys. They're expecting all that.
Yeah, I mean, they're really taking advantage of the fact that he does not have that extra web up. You can see Aggressive is trying to get as much harassment in, but as the second web does go down now, Misery should be fine for kind of the rest of the laning phase unless they bring in extra counter wards off of that early first blood. Puppy is going for the zoning out of XZ here. You can see the Spirit and the right-click damage already doing a lot to the Clockwork. And looks like the pull is actually going to go well for Puppy, though. The Sander's actually going to go down, and the rest of these creeps will push forward, so Clockwork will be able to pick up a decent amount of experience as the creep equilibrium shifts into his favor.
Now, this is one trade he actually might not want to do, and it's an Ogre Magi. He does a lot of damage, but
yeah.
Ogre does a lot as well, and he has Boots advantage and definitely more survivability with that 7 armor, so Puppy's met his match.
In the middle lane, this is definitely one of the more interesting matchups, Windranger versus the SF. CS-wise, well, top lane, Echo Stomp is actually going to be able to land it. Eternal Envy will close the distance with that Clockwork and get a couple more right clicks in. Just some harassment, but still, you can see the power of that combination if they start getting higher levels of Echo Stomp. And as a 4 position, that's actually very likely. We saw some Echo Stomps maxed out by support Elder Titans before.
Yeah, the Astral Spirit is not... It's basically better at level 1 than it used to be, so you can kind of get away with leaving the points sort of low and going for more levels of Echo Stomp or Natural Order. It's a very rare build in the past. Even support Elder Titans would skip Echo Stomp until like level 9 or something, because they were just opting for as much damage and aura as possible. But I think the game might change a little bit, at least the way that people play Elder Titan.
Do you think that which one do you value more? The early aura in this game against some of these agility heroes that really benefit from that natural armor that they have, or do you think that the extra bit of control of that Echo Stomp will be better?
I think you can get away with 2 levels of Echo Stomp. You don't need more than that. 2 is going to give you about just enough time to use your ultimate, the Earth Splitter.
Right.
And in most cases, a 3-second disable is plenty. So that's my guess.
Misery is possibly going to go down here once again. The Dust has spotted him out. And Aggressive in Q get yet another kill. Meanwhile, in the middle lane, Gardner makes his rotation over to Pylai Dai and Weeha, who's already dropped a little bit of HP, but he does have those 2 different bottle charges. And Pylai Dai has been sitting behind him for a lot of this part. Looks like the CS wise 13-1 on the SS, 16-6 on Weeha, so a slight advantage going to the Windranger right now, but once you start getting into level 5, level 7 of the SF, that's really where he starts taking over, especially if he has stacks available. But with all the aggression of this Ogre Magi, I mean, this is a very distinct choice that Garter made, rather than, you know, sitting back and sitting behind the middle lane and stacking up for the SF, especially with Radiant side advantage. He instead played into the enemy jungle, and you know, we saw him harassing Puppy earlier, was putting pressure on Weeha aggressively by sneaking behind him. Why do you think that is? Why do you think he chose for the much more offensive play?
I was actually going to compliment him there. Even though he's level 1 and he doesn't have 2 yet, I think he's really accomplished a lot. And the main things he's accomplished is that Pylite Eye hasn't done very much.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason he's been sitting by the tower so often is because he doesn't always know where Ogre is. He knows that if Ogre finds him solo, that he could just die to it. Because he doesn't have boots. He's 280 movement speed. The Ogre is running at 345. He could very easily run him down. And he also disables Pi's ability to just free farm, grab neutral camps, get more levels, and power mana to his entire team.
All right, well, apparently things are already getting very tense in this match, as one of the players apparently already broke one of their keyboards. So, yeah, that's what that pause was for. But we're here now, 3.5 minutes in.
How do you do that?
I'm not sure, but maybe just nerves. Maybe just nerves.
What hero that's currently being played could break their keyboard? Shadow Fiend may be like, raise now, hurry!
Raise one, raise two!
It's cool. Way cooler when you say it. It's like you're flying an airplane.
It was Misery.
Okay.
He was the one who died twice.
He
so
has
that's...
died twice. Was yeah. that? Was that a rage keyboard? I don't know. Probably not.
No, I'm sure. Maybe just like spamming out.
So a couple stacks going on for Secret here with their supports. Heroes that could kill this. Windranger can deal with these. Eternal Envy can also kill them. He's usually, most Razor players will be maxing Plasma Field first. So, and especially to the two camps they're doing the medium camp and, well, both medium camps. You can actually pull these together and then hit them both with Plasma Field.
Plasma Field, yeah.
Plasmic sounds cool. It's not real though.
Pylite Eye is also obviously going to be taking advantage of the hard camp and may stack that like the smaller creeps up together as he's going to be clearing through the bigger ones. Oh, they're going to catch out Misery here. Garter once again comes in with his haste rune this time around, and Misery will go down. He's going to turn around and just try and get damage out on a Q, but the Golden Brace keeps him alive, and all these Spiderlings have dust on them as well, so can't really play that aggressively anymore. And a third pick off on that Broodmother. We were kind of questioning whether or not the pick would actually be effective, seeing as CDC had some decent heroes to deal with it, especially going into the mid game. But apparently the laning phase is going to be all the more difficult for Misery than we thought.
Yeah, that was a very tough gank to evade, but he could have spread his spiderlings a little bit more. He put 4 in a clump to the left of the trees, and if he just spread them out a little bit like this, he would have probably seen at least one of those heroes as they approach. So you could maybe call it lazy micro, but the ganks from CDC have been really good so far. Here's a stun coming on the clockwork. Eternal Envy is not even going to try for this. It's only a 2-second. Oh, it is actually 3-second. He does opt for delaying the natural order. I think this is going to be just fine.
Yeah, I really like your idea of just the 2 levels in Acro Stomp. I feel like maxing out from there is perhaps a little unnecessary, maybe secondary, but the natural order is probably just too valuable early on.
They could use it for shackles and stuff too, actually. That's
another
way they could use it. Not that he needs that. We already saw Weeha just like, oh, you're moving like crazy, I'll still shackle you, but it'll help.
Or Pylite Eye getting in position for some sort of freezing field play as well.
Hide in a tree and then ult, something like that.
Or if he has more time farming up the jungle, which Garter is actually spending more time in the Radiant jungle stacking up right now, so that's possible for Pylite Eye to farm a bit better, he can get that early Glimmer Cape that we oftentimes see out of Crystal Maidens, and that's a great defensive technique that has a lot of synergy with the freezing field channeling.
They also don't have the best AoE disables. Like, if you're invisible and you're playing Alina or Lesh, it's not a big deal because you know about where he's standing.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, they've got pretty much Hookshot, maybe Cogs, Winter, Wyvern ulti, and that's about it. They don't have the best ways to deal with it this game, so we could really see Pylite Eye have a big impact when he does press his ultimate.
So despite the fact that Misery has died 3 different times here, this is still a Broodmother who's been playing pretty aggressively, and that's why he's died. It's sort of the trade-off, right? When you play that aggressively, you're more likely to get picked off, but you're also getting a full amount of experience and oftentimes a lot of gold, and you can see that reflected in the difference between the offlaner's Misery just picked up his level 6 while Clockwork still struggling to get level 5. A big difference in these two, and the Broodmother's naturally going to be a lot more effective despite feeding a lot of gold over to the Gyrocopter in that defensive tri lane.
He will, but they have so many defensive countermeasures. Like, Cold Embrace alone just stops all spider damage for 4 seconds, except for the poison damage over time, of course. And Gyrocopter can as well cover himself. When Clock at 6, for example, he can go mid and have one other hero show up, and he could solo kill the Windranger. Like, that's so dangerous for Weehaw here, because he's probably not going to want a Force Staff early game. It puts his Ags too far behind, so there is going to be a very long period in the game where Clock is a real threat on the map, whereas Broodmother still is going to take maybe 10 seconds to kill somebody, and either Clock or Winter Wyvern can TP to support them.
Which means that it oftentimes becomes a battle over control of the jungle, right? Because the Broodmother can't show himself as often as lane, he's going to spend more time in the enemy jungle and trying to take that away from the Gyrocopter and the SF, especially some of those stacks. So we could see these supports essentially battling it out with the Broodmother, you know, trying to gank him when he's going for all these neutral camps and limiting CDEC's farm in that way.
Yeah, I'd really agree with that. The control of the jungle is really big, especially if you're a hero that can jungle very easily, like Shadow Fiend or Gyrocopter. If you don't give him as many camps to farm, he's got to rely on stacking and being super efficient with his time. But he would love to just go to the jungle, kill everything rapidly, stay off the map, and not have any ganks come his way. So killing this tier 1 tower for Secret is very important on the bot lane. It'll make a really big difference. We got a bit of a replay here coming up. This is one of the ganks on Misery. That haste rune just did so much.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, Gardner being able to find that in the bottom lane. And Misery, I mean, he did the best that he could. He can micro the Broodlings very early on to go onto the Winter Wyvern. Brought him a little low, but as you said, that Cold Embrace is just going to be so effective versus the Broodmother.
And with this good start, too, they just have so many good heroes for transitioning into being good against Broodmother.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every time he throws a Splinter Blast, he's going to kill, like, a third of the spiders, because it does 340 damage. It's on a really low cooldown. You can spam that ability for days, so...
Yeah, especially with the early amount of gold that he's gotten, I really love to see Soul Rings on Winter Wyverns, because that really just speeds up your farm so much. And then you can start going, you know, Tranquil Boots and then into the, you know, Glimmer Cape or something like that, some sort of great utility item from the Winter Wyvern.
It's good to stopping pushes as well. That part's quite nice. If Secret's approaching, for example, throw on a creep wave, slow them all for a bit. What is the slow duration, by the way? It is 4 seconds. We were curious about that yesterday. It's actually a very good skill. You could hypothetically slow for 25% at 4 out of the 7 seconds with this ability. Not to mention the 340 damage that it packs out. I really think that's I don't want to say best skill, but it's a really good skill.
It's
just a little hard to use.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, there's just that... basically one circumstance where it's only one hero and he's running away and you're like, oh, if only I had a nuke that would actually directly deal damage to that hero. But I feel like there are so many other situations where Splinter Blast excels that it really makes up for that one, you know, that one unique scenario that it doesn't actually be effective at all. Winter Wyvern, let's actually talk about Team Secret and CDC going into the late game a bit, because we do have some much more traditional heroes, especially heroes that we've seen a lot in this patch and the last patch on CDC. Gyrocopter, SF, even the heroes like Winter Wyvern, we've had a lot of exposure to in the last few months. But Secret do have the Elder Titan, which is a huge support buff up in the late game with that aura. We also have the Razor and Windranger, who are, I would say, your little bit atypical late game carries, but can be monsters, even as late as 50 to 60 minutes.
Yeah, more likely to be Windranger being really strong. This is the first time that Misery died here on the replay. He played this pretty well, and then the Rocket Barrage came in.
Yeah, again, it just comes down to the fact that he used the web at that bottom room.
Yeah.
And then he had, you know, through the next web.
This is the second time he died. This one was a bit more surprising, but yeah. Mizuru just kept getting killed by two heroes, and that's... He maybe should have just played a little safer. He probably just genuinely didn't think that he was going to die in those circumstances, but CDC played it very well. So we're back into the live game here. I think Secret is going to be sitting pretty well late game, like you said. Windranger and Razor are a bit atypical, but they're going to be damage amped due to the fact of the Elder Titan aura, which reduces armor and magic resistance.
Misery, already doing battling with the supports, trying to control the pulls. And this is one of the big sad things for supports, is that pulling against a Broodmother is just never effective.
Well, highlight eye shifting over as well.
They actually gets a couple of those small spiderlings, but... Misery will probably just clean up the camp from there. Garter, meanwhile, is sitting middle lane. Shiki's going to start clearing through some of those stacks, and Garter will either share that experience or sit middle and get the experience there. And it looks like he's going to share that camp. just trying to get that level 6 faster. Ogre Magi is another hero that we have to talk about late game that can be so insanely good if he actually gets that Aghanim's and he gets a little lucky on those multicasts. We do have somewhat fragile heroes on Secret, most notably thinking about this Windranger and how she's perhaps a bit more glass cannon than others.
Yeah, even a hero like Elder Titan usually has to worry about burst magic damage kind of thing.
Yeah.
Because his he doesn't buy that many HP items usually. I like Pilot Eye's rotation to the offlane. It's nice to pressure this early because a lot of players don't expect a support to be there. And he could just be jungling this whole time. And that's why he's basically waiting for so long. Because him not doing anything is maybe more dangerous for his opponents than it is him showing on the map and getting a bit more farm. Because then they don't know where he is. They have to play safer in their mid lane. Like Shadow Fiend, for example, went to the jungle. So he's happy. But some of the other lanes, they're really scared right now because they didn't know where Pi is. But now they do. And Gyrocopter has to sit back as well as Ogre.
Yeah, I oftentimes feel like people give a little bit too much respect to the Gyrocopter because, you know, he can be such a powerhouse in that 15-minute mark and play very aggressive as a carry, that they oftentimes don't even try and stand up against him in the laning phase. But he is still a very squishy hero. And if you look at the setup that could happen with the CM and Broodmother, you know, you get a slow, you get a trap there from the Frostbite, and then Broodmother's just going to run down the Gyrocopter, and that Rocket Barrage is going to be completely mitigated by the sheer number of spiders. But he's going to run into Q here, rapidly surrounding him with Broodlings, throw out the Splinter Blast, and oh, the last bit of nuke damage is enough to be able to finish him off. Puppy throws out the stomp, but it doesn't catch Sheiky either. And Sheik will just continue to farm up that camp.
So no aura yet on the Elder Titan, but all of a sudden the carries are very pressured. And I agree with that. Gyrocopter is actually pretty counterable here. Dust popped on Misery, but all he's got to do is slow down the Ogre, and he is just fine.
Yeah, it doesn't even catch really any of the Spiderlings with that call down. Meanwhile, look at Eternal Envy just camping out between the tier 1 and tier 2 tower because he can, because his team is putting so much pressure in that bottom lane. And, you know, the 1 versus 1 matchup, Clockwork and Razor, especially Razor with an advantage, is very clearly going to go the way of the Razor.
The only way that Razor would die there is if a support TPs and Clock would instantly hook, but Clock's completely out of mana, so Envy realizes that he doesn't have to worry about that, and the other three players on his team can continue pressuring the safe lane. And this is actually putting them in a really good advantage, because Weehaw's maybe a little behind the Shadow Fiend, but he's trading, and now the Gyro isn't as safe to farm, so I feel like they're winning about two lanes now instead of what was happening before. So I like this rotation coming out of Secret.
Yeah, I mean, these heroes are, I feel, so dependent on being able to have the jungle available to them, both Gyrocopter and SF. Yeah, Puppy gets stunned up, but he will be able to get enough movement speed out of that Spirit that he quickly dances away. Weehaw is obviously getting a lot of space in that middle lane as well. He's actually second in the net worth chart. SF obviously taking the top slot, but that's not surprising. Oh, oh no, the hook shot goes into the catapult. That's a change up at 6.85 right there. And Weehaw just gets a shackle shot and a power shot to harass those imposing gankers.
And yeah. Hook, arrow, hook shot, everything. All that stuff is going to hit. No.
Slow comes out, but it's just creating space for Misery to start beating on this tier 1 tower. And you said it was very important for Team Secret to take down this tier 1 as soon as possible, and they seem to be finding the opening, though. Garter's making his way around. I feel like they're going to need a bit more than just an Ogre Magi kind of leading the way for the team.
And he's happy to do it. He's obviously not going to kill everybody, but he can take so much damage, especially with Tranquil Boots now. He's got 12 armor.
Oh, what a great shackle shot in the middle lane. Weehaw throws out that focus fire and hoping to be able to get a little bit lucky, but the one goes out and Sheik is just turning and fighting. Weehaw is forced to a win run back. And Aggressive misses out on that ultimate, but still, he makes sure the SF stays alive.
Spirit is looking for a kill behind the tower. They spot off Q. They know he's there. Will they dive it?
He still has that Arctic Burn to try and fly away. He does get stunned up, but he's ready to throw out that Q and see if he can get out. Splinter Blast. Oh, he actually goes for the Cold Embrace to start things off, but he's just going to get bursted down by the magic damage.
Man, I was about to criticize Puppy for not having a single point in his aura yet. It's about 40% of the effectiveness with one skill point. He finally grabbed it, so he's going to be fine. He doesn't need his ultimate, but he's got three levels of Echo Stomp here. It's pretty amazing. The skill was buffed in AoE, but not in a huge amount, and all of a sudden the build has completely changed. But I really like this change. He's still fine with low levels of Natural Order and Astral Spirit, and he can really put a lot of disable into his opponents and let his team set up.
Yeah, especially on those awkward dives underneath the safe lane tower, that long duration stun actually sets up so much. XD is looking for the hook shot here in the middle lane. He knows Weehaw's low on HP and mana, but Weehaw is going to back up to base, and The tier 1 tower may be forfeit, but nope, Secret actually going to rotate Eternal Envy now into this tier 2 tower and put a stop to the push by CDEZ.
They both have mechs, that's the important thing, so any advantage that one team has is pretty much offset by the other one. Now it just comes down to how you play your heroes and how the initiations go. Initiations being so important, obviously. Clockwork's got hooked, hopefully Brambi doesn't catch another catapult, but it's looking pretty good right now. He's going to go on Envy.
Eternal Envy just puts himself on the front line, has that mech, but he needs to be able to get it off, does get it off alongside the magic wand, but he still ends up going down to the focus fire of CDEC. Speaking of focus fire, that's what Weeha's doing XZ right now, but the power shot misses, and the clockwork slips away. Team Secret lose one, but they still have Misery ready to enter in from the side. Start throwing out those broodlings, but, oh man, Q drops so low to that combination of the spirit and the power shot. The spiders aren't going to find their opening. Misery unable to throw out the nuke, and CDEC seem to just get the free pickoff on Eternal Envy and retreat to safety.
Yeah, that's the power of Clockwork, man. He makes one of your heroes just not move for a couple seconds. And in the early game, that's too dangerous if they're out of position. Maybe Envy shouldn't have been that far up, but he should have anticipated the potential of a hookshot and a cog coming in. If he could have walked back after those first disables, he would have been absolutely fine. But with the cogs in there, he gets picked off and unfortunately uses up his first team fight. Not that big of a deal, but you know they would have loved to win that fight.
Yeah, I can't really blame Eternal Envy for thinking he could go that far forward, right? With these, like, I've got strength treads, I've got mech, I've got 13 magic wand charges or something along that line. And that still just wasn't enough. I think he expected maybe a little bit more control, like the Elder Titan to come in with a stomp at the right time, but...
He did, but Rocket Barrage just keeps plugging away.
Yep.
He's asleep at the controls, but his machine continues, man.
Oh, they're gonna pick up! No! XZ misses out on the hookshot. Nice sidestep from Puppy. And, Misery is actually looking to see. Well, Ogre Magi, that's going to take a while to eat through. And while in the meantime, that Splinter Blast is going to cause you issues, Carter. It's being run down. They do get a dust onto Misery, but they're not going to do anything with it. Just happy to keep their supports alive.
I think Puppy definitely needs to max out his aura next. I think that's the next stage. I guess he'll finish Astral Spirit. Just for the bonus damage that he could get, but he really needs this aura to be maxed out because it's going to kill a lot of advantage that the raiding team has. They obviously haven't had a straight team fight where it's just doing tons of damage to their opponents. It's always like Weeha's focus firing one guy, but that armor and magic reduction difference is going to make a huge change in the team fights when they actually start.
When do you think he starts like getting that ult? Oh, Pilot Eye is going to be picked off. Runs right into the ward. He was hoping to be able to get a counter ward. He's actually going to get some distance away, perhaps enough to be able to ensure a counter kill, but he's certainly dead. Now Puppy actually kind of runs in, does get caught as well. Eternal Envy in from the side, but the mech keeps everyone from CDEC still healthy. While meanwhile, Aggressif is actually trying to chase down Weeha, might be able to catch up to him as he pops the drops and everything else. Hookshot over on the side onto Eternal Envy. If they pick off this Razor again, Eternal Envy's going to be so far behind in farm, and sure enough, they easily have enough damage. Even with Aggressif wrapping around on this side, and all this really leaves is Team Secret pushing out the bottom lane with Misery, but he doesn't get really any damage done to that tier 2 tower, and Aggressive is quick to respond.
They're really just getting run over here. I mean, the first death, it happens. You're going to D-ward at a common spot, but both supports just happen to be there. But every kill that happened after, Puppy definitely didn't need to approach there. He was like, oh, maybe I can pressure these two supports. Shadow Fiend's there, boom, he dies. Just kind of careless mistakes to make there that were risks that they didn't need to take. And the other deaths that followed afterwards was as a result of Puppy doing that. Pylai Dai's death was completely fine. Puppy's was not.
We have a minus on our Broodmother, level 11. Misery trying to make the best out of the space that he's been given. Weeha, not terribly surprising, just going for the Aghanim's build.
I like what you said about Elder Titan ult, though. It's definitely time to get it. He's already got so many levels of his stomp. Why not grab it? You can throw it out there. It can segment the fight a little bit. If things are going really bad, you're going to have a huge damage amplification spell. And by that, I mean, it's going to do a lot of damage.
Yeah, and the movement speed slow is not bad. Like, obviously, you're not going to level it up past one. The effectiveness of level 2 and level 3, I think, don't really match your basic abilities and the way that they can scale forward. But just one level, I think, would be rather valuable. Another stomp goes out, not catching Shiki. But at this point in time, he could almost, like, bait a stomp because CDEC are going for a 4-man aggressive smoke gank into the enemy jungle. And don't tell me they're going to catch Eternal Envy again. You got
gotta get out of the way of XC. Aggressive does provide the space, and they locked out Eternal Envy. But this time around, it's underneath the Tier 2 tower. They just throw everything they have to be able to pop him, and they are successful. Cold Embrace. Actually, Weehaw's gonna be locked down by the Winter's Curse. Aggressive moves forward. Missile is gonna be able to land on Weehaw, but it's not gonna be enough damage by itself, and Aggressive has to try and get out of here. Meanwhile, XC hit by the Stomp. Cold Embrace does save him. Now a Mech keeps him alive through the new Power Shot, right through the heart of the clockwork, and he does go down, but Puppy is the trade-off, and ZDEC still easily winning these fights.
They just have such strong heroes right now. It's very difficult for Secret to take this. If it's a straight team fight, Secret's going to be all right, but if it starts with these ganks and little engagements, they've got the power of Gyro, Clockwork, Ogre, Winter Wyvern. They just do so much damage. Their disables are easy. Once the hookshot was landed, Envy was just dead, so they're just outplaying their opponents right now. They took the early advantage, and they're just pressing it more.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that's why Sheiky, like, basically reading that and reading, okay, we have such superior team fight route, that's why he goes for that little bit greedy, like, Blink Dagger pickup rather than the straight into BKB after the mech? He just thinks, I can take advantage of the fact that we're winning fights and push this even further, maybe get that extra pick off because of the Blink Dagger.
And I don't think it's just that. I think it's also to dodge Echo Stomp from the Elder Titan. That's another thing that he's going to be able to evade easier. Yeah, maybe he'll take the Spirit damage, but if he doesn't stomp for a couple seconds afterwards? If that's right. The case, he can definitely blink away.
Well, Team Secret ready with a response here. They're definitely losing this game in the first 20 minutes, but they are able to pick up Roshan and snag the Aegis for Weehaw.
So with that grabbed, I think they're in a decent position. The net worth is actually still in their favor because they've just been farming the whole time, I guess.
Yeah.
The ganks have been good and the kills are heavy on CDEC, but Windranger has not stopped farming. 94 CS on him. Pyladai hasn't done a whole lot this game, mostly sitting behind people, but all the other heroes, Envy especially, has fought a lot. Yeah, he's died 3 times, but other than those few times that he got killed, he's been off grabbing creeps the whole time.
Yeah, he's actually, I'm rather surprised that his net worth is still above the Gyrocopters, who hasn't died yet. Sure, he hasn't picked up a lot of these kills that he's been a part of, only one of them has gone to his favor, but I just would have expected him not dying would have been enough. But that comes down to the aggressive behavior from
exactly.
Team Secret, right? Those two supports in the in that lane with the Broodmother, it just cut off aggressive at his legs.
Yeah, it hurt him for a couple minutes in there, hurt his farming speed, and because that Eternal Envy is about 25 CS above him, so Envy's still fine, honestly. He's going to go Axe afterwards, Point Booster, and the Ogre Club now, most likely Axe. It'll help him kill a lot of those heroes if he does get in melee range, but
right.
Secret just needs to continue farming, keep their farm up, and then just take a good fight. So far, it's all been kind of bad fights, but I guess they're feeling confident right now. Like, they're ahead in gold. I don't know if they're going to feel like that, because I've definitely felt very thrown off this game as well in terms of gold advantage, but
yeah.
Secret's going to be okay with this. I'm sure they're going to play through it.
Yeah, obviously a huge part of the gold advantage that is still going to Team Secret. 2,500 comes down to the 4-tower lead that they have. CDC have yet to be able to pick up a single one of these Tier 1s, and that's perhaps them focusing maybe a bit too much in kills, would you say? That they're, you know, diving into Tier 2 towers, and yet they have yet to take a Tier 1. Pilot Eye is going to be snagged up here in the top lane. XC found that opening with a great rocket flare. Pilot Eye's TP cut short.
Nice little gank there. XC's been playing great, 5-1-1. Despite the really tough early laning stage, he's transitioned really well into kills. So, good for him. Yeah, I think CDEC has maybe been over-ganking a little bit, but it does allow them to move around the map more, I feel. So maybe they're getting out-farmed. It's the safer style, it's just to farm rather than to do aggressive things, but they're making things work here.
Weehaw just takes the first call down worth the damage. And it looks like CDC are actually going to back up, so another Tier 1 tower kept alive for Team Secret. They just hold so much more map control right now. And going back to XZ, I mean, he has been doing very well, and I'm really surprised at the items that he's already picked up. He has a Blademail plus another 1,700 gold, which I'm presuming is going to be going into the 4-staff. Just that added utility. You will be close range oftentimes with the Razor, and who knows with the Broodmother and Windranger what their items are going to be, but if they start picking up a BKB or something, you know.
He went Ghost Scepter.
Oh, okay.
It's a better solution against Focus Fire, for sure.
Yeah.
Also gives them an option against Brood. Brood can't just permanently slow him. Kind of the same thing with Razor. I would have thought that this was going to be a 4-staff, especially because a lot of Secret is finishing forces. The Elder Titan, I believe, has got his flying out. Crystal Maiden's awfully close as well, about 500 gold away. And once they have those, it basically counteracts Hookshot. So sometimes you need a 4-staff to anti-counter that, so
yeah.
That you can 4-staff after the people that are forced escaping. So, but I also like this option as well. It's going to allow him to basically stay in melee melee range and do damage, whereas the Force is more of an escape thing. If he gets Ghost, he can hang out for a couple more seconds, maybe get some extra damage that could lead to kills.
Eternal Envy. He almost has that Aghanim Scepter. Just another 1,000 gold. He'll have that complete. And it feels like at that point in time, Team Secret can actually go for the rest of these tier 2 towers. And it feels like CDEC are like doing a good job fighting and everything else, and they're just waiting on these next set of items before they can actually go for 5-man objectives. But what items are those, do you think, Purge? What needs to be finished up for CDEC before they can take some tier 1s?
Well, Gyrocopter is finishing Asanjin Yasha, which normally I'd say is the go-to Gyrocopter item, but I'm not so sure I like it that much this game because it is still an agility-based item, at least partially, and he's going to be losing that armor. So some of the value you get from the item is definitely going to be weakened. With that said, there's not really a good solution otherwise.
Yeah, Gardner's going to get picked off. At the very least, you could say it gives you a bit of strength. Aggressive, he's going to go down to Misery here. Clockwork Rocket comes in, maybe cleans up some of those vitals. But Misery shutting down that Gyrocopter, such a big pickup, and we may never see an opportunity for CDC to take a tier 1 tower. And that obviously is so much the net worth advantage of Team Secret, but if they can control this game long enough for another 5 to 10 minutes, you may even see them pushing uphill without a single tier 1 to CDC's name.
That's another reason that they are ahead in farm. It's that Midas. It's been going off for about 15 minutes now, getting them a lot of gold advantage, and the medallion on top of that basically gives Brood all of this good pushing power and a lot of solo kill potential. The medallion is still a great item for killing people.
The Aegis just went down. They know this is the opportunity to be able to pop Eternal Envy straight up. He gets a force staff over to the side, but not gonna escape. The last raise and rocket will help finish him off. Puppy, the next hero? No, they have to back up because Misery is very rapidly pushing down that tier 3 tower now.
Really good reads from CDEC. Took the timer, looked at it, said, okay, time to initiate. They go in and boom. They actually get Eternal Envy in that moment where he doesn't quite realize that his timer is almost up as well. And that's just better game sense and better note-taking by CDEC there than Eternal Envy.
And maybe it's the opportunity now for CDEC, with the Aegis down, to push out a little bit. Pylite Dime maybe caught by Aggressive, but...
And the opposite, potentially. Yeah. If he would have stayed in the jungle, Weehawk could have shifted over. He's got a Blink and a DD. This could be a kill. Can he catch both?
Carter.
He's thinking about it. Oh, this
if
looks good.
If he manages to get it with the line, can't quite get it there, and will be rebuffed by the Rock of Barrage from Aggressive. And they do have the Winter Wyvern coming in as well. No Winter's Curse just yet. Sheiky gonna commit for the tier 1 tower, but oh no! Puppy gets a beautiful Echo Stomp, takes the deny, and now Sheiky will get turned around as Weehaw completes his TP.
You do not have to be Weehaw to get that shackle, and
nope.
As soon as that stomp landed, that was a kill. Really nicely done. Good setup there by Puppy, and that is the strength of the heroes. That disable duration is massive. It's like a Naga Siren Sleep. Practically.
Hold in, Q is going to be caught by another stomp here. He gets the slow and a pylon dive, but call down actually catches Puppy. Aggressive right, committing for that one, but Eternal Envy's here for the turnaround. Weehaw's already cleaned up the support behind Aggressive, so he's left alone, a man in the island. Tries to go for Puppy, but he just gets ripped apart by Team Secret. Weehaw is actually going to be forced back. Misery, meanwhile, taking that tier 3 tower, and XD just desperate to try and stop it.
Oh, gets a shackle. It's Ogre is really strong, guys. He might survive here. There's this.
Oh, is he going to turn it around? Is that enough damage? Weehaw, he's going to tick, 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 but I don't think the ignite's going to be enough, so
it's
he will survive.
Going to be close. 22 HP there for Weehaw. I'm sure you're scared about that one. Ignite, a very good skill. He did have level 4 as well, so one of the. It does 400 damage with 4 skill points. It's a really good skill.
Look at poor XD. He's just like using everything in his arsenal. Battery Assault, Rocket Flare, even used the hook shot earlier just to try and clear through some of these Spiderlings, and they do take a lot of damage on that that ranged Rax. Misery knew that he was going to be rebuffed before he can complete a Rax, so he might as well take the one that doesn't regen.
Can we just give Misery props here? He went 0-3 in his lane, and he's the top net worth in the game right now.
Yeah.
He just gets item after item after item. Such good value coming out of his items here.
CDC, speaking of which, have we actually seen them? I feel like we haven't seen them use too many smokes, or at least they haven't been very effective.
Yeah, they really haven't smoked that often. They do a lot of rotations, but they don't leverage on smokes unnecessarily, I would maybe argue. Maybe it's just they know they can react to that kind of stuff. Like, they've done a lot of dewarding as well. If you do the dewarding, then you don't really need to smoke unless it's daytime. So, just seems like good play from them. Not necessarily something they have to crutch on to... They just have such good map awareness. They don't need
it. Oh, XZ. He's going to be spotted out here unless we get a really lucky hookshot from XZ. They're not going to find the Broodmother. They'll take down the wards, or at least they should. XZ? Yeah.
Gem Dove definitely makes things easier
yeah.
when you're ganking a brood.
Rocket yeah, but I feel like through. That's one of those situations, right? If they'd smoked and gone through and cleared through their own jungle, they would have stumbled onto that brood mother.
Yeah. They probably didn't want to do that because they're like, oh, we have a gem. We don't need to waste the smoke on it.
Yeah.
Or we've already got the vision. The smoke plus dust play is a much easier way to find brood. But in that case, they didn't get him. So he is becoming a problem, though. I mean, he's already gotten the tier 3 tower. The range barracks is at half HP. They can't leave their base for long. Otherwise, they're going
to
lose it.
Yeah, and it just opens up the whole entire field to Team Secret to farm up. You've got the Ags now complete on the Racer, plus another 1,800 gold for Eternal Envy. We also see in the jungle, Weeha farming away with his Blink Dagger Ags, and another 2,000 there. And Roshan's going to be coming up soon. All the pressure at that bottom lane is making this whole entire field a playhouse for Team Secret. They should be able to take Roshan rather easily, though I'm sure CDC, maybe that's one of the reasons why I was looking at them. They only had one smoke at that time. Maybe that's why they didn't go for the smoke into their own jungle, because they knew, hey, Roshan's going to be coming up soon. We're going to have to smoke if we want to interrupt that.
No stun on the Ogre Magi in the mid lane. Looks like CDC is pretty much ready to fight. Sandra Nyasha ready on Shadow Fiend. He did get that early BKB down to 9 seconds. Maybe not the best item to grab in the early game, because it doesn't really increase your farming speed, but the Blink and the Yasha definitely do. Mobility items get you from camp to camp faster, so you can kill them more rapidly.
They know, man, how many heroes are there in that middle lane thanks to the wards, and they're going to go straight for the range racks here. Misery, full committal here. Yeah, looks like it. The cooldown comes out, but the Spiderlings are just enough to clear through it. It gives a decent amount of gold to Aggressive, but obviously a big win for Team Secret. And now you might as well back up, go straight to Roshan while you know CDC are inside their own base.
Yeah, Weeha was there too as well, but it didn't really look like a good Shackle opportunity, so not too surprising to see him give up on that. He's got 2,000 gold, nothing new since then. Can't wait for his Daedalus, it's going to do a lot of damage. Maybe he'll even go Deso or something, because they already have a lot of minus armor. Stacking it isn't the worst thing.
Yeah, that wouldn't be a bad idea, and offers more split pushing opportunities as well, but no, we're going to go for the traditional Crystallis build, picked up by him.
Hope he's just following heroes with his spirits.
Oh, Misery. What a nuisance he's become. He's cutting the creep wave a little bit and actually sitting inside of the enemy base while CDC push out.
Puppy's playing his hero so well. He's functioning like so many other strong heroes. He's functioning like a bounty hunter.
Mm-hmm.
He's getting vision with his spear. Look, he finds him again.
Yeah.
Now they know exactly where CDEC is, and then go farm somewhere else. This time, though, they may actually go for a fight.
Eternal Envy, yeah, they're smoked up right now. They're gonna go jump on AXC with a focus fire. That's gonna be easy. Quick kill, or maybe not. The cold embrace, and they do have the stun onto Eternal Envy. Sheikah's gonna let loose that ultimate. Winter's Curse right on top. They're throwing everything they have at Eternal Envy, and they should be able to get him. But is there a turnaround from Team Secret? They hit that Elder Titan ultimate in the background. Misery committing for Aggressive. Gets locked inside the cog. No, he actually gets out Aggressive. He's getting away with the Glimmer Cape. They multicast it up Misery, but he still wants the Gyrocopter so badly, and he will have him. The nuke comes down now. Just the right click, turns another one into babies, and Misery just controlling this game. Shiki dies in a flame, and there goes Zedek. They're gone, only for two of Team Secret, Razor and Crystal Maiden, the only two who go down, and that's going to be CDC forced into buybacks potentially, maybe just giving up this melee racks. They only have two buybacks against three heroes. It may not even be worth it.
Ooh, a missed glyph there. That was, it actually had backdoor protection. They could have saved that. Watch, as soon as this ends, they've still got backdoor. What a waste.
Backdoor protection now going to fall as the creeps move forward, but that's going to be melee racks down. CDC, they say if we buy back there and try and defend with only two heroes and we lose that, the game's practically over.
Yeah, it was definitely going to die anyways, so maybe not the biggest deal in the world. But with that racks going down, I feel like, oh, we have a bit of a replay coming up here. That's
yeah,
initiation.
You can see the initiation there onto Weeha. They does get the save of the Cold Embrace, but they just throw everything they have, the Eternal Envy. The problem's going to be, if you can see up there, the Gyrocopter's HP is taken down this whole entire time. So CDC, yeah, you've won the fight, but now you have to go save this Gyrocopter. You have to throw everything you have to be able to save your carry, and that Echo Stomp, what a beautiful one. Three heroes go down. None of them can really save Aggressive at that point in time, and they're just getting picked apart by Team Secret from behind.
That stomp really was game winning, and even though Eternal Envy's stats aren't very good this game, I really feel like he's accomplishing a lot. He's forcing his opponents to spend a lot of spells on him, and I'm glad he didn't get BKB for that reason.
Oh, look at that, the zoning ultimate. CDC, they know they have to get the hook shot. It even gets interrupted. XE was hoping for the big YOLO play, but that's not gonna happen here. Eternal Envy, are they gonna throw everything they have on him once again? Remember, he's got a pipe picked up. You can't just throw magic damage at this Razor anymore.
He's barely taking any damage at all, actually.
I really like this build on Razor in some games, and this is one of the ones. He doesn't need to stay alive and do damage. He's got a Windranger that's doing really well. He's got a Broodmother that's top net worth, and he's even got supports that can do a lot of damage and disruption. So he's just saying, hit me with your stuff, I'm going to reduce it as much as possible, and then you're not going to be able to throw it on my other.
Oh, the jump in, slow, Misery pops out the webs and is going to try and lock down one of these heroes. Glimmercape buys some time. XZ takes some extra damage. Weehawk goes for the Jackal shot, maybe just a power shot to finish him off. Cold Embrace keeps him alive for a little bit longer. They do get the Winter's Curse, but doesn't catch Weehawk, throws out the hook shot, but he dies in the process of getting to him. And now Misery just keeps running forward. That BKB slowing down Garter will catch Q instead. That'll be a second kill going to Team Secret. Now the stun on Nishiki right in front of the fountain. Don't think Team Secret can force that fight just yet, but what they can do is turn around and take this second lane of Brax.
Not really that much they can do about this. They can spam Ignites, I guess. Maybe some long-range races.
Oh, but what a Shackle shot! Weeha sees the opportunity. Gyrocopter just crumples. So too is this Yogurt Magi Fall. And Cheeky, he's left alone against all of this and will die. And that's it. CDC call it for game number one. They had the kill advantage early on, but Team Secret just knew how to play this game through and through. Split push, found way more farming opportunities, and just got themselves a rather large lead.
It's maybe one solution against the hyper-aggressive. We saw this a lot at TI5 as well. Though some of the Chinese teams would group up and they'd go around the map together, and it was really hard to teamfight them. The solution